Hello, everyone. It's good to have you tonight. Glad that you're here. Grab a hymnal, turn to hymn number 250, and let's all stand. Hymn number 250 tonight. He keeps me singing. Boy, I tell you, you need to learn to have a song days like this. Sing it with me on the first. There's within my heart a melody. Sing it with me. Here we go. There's within my heart a melody. Jesus whispers sweet and low. Fear not, I am with thee. Peace be still. In all of life's ebb and flow. Here we go. Jesus, 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 sweetest name I know. Fills my every longing, keeps me singing as I go. On the last now, soon he's coming back to welcome me. Far beyond the starry sky, I shall wing my flight to worlds unknown. I shall reign with him on high. Here we go. Jesus, Jesus, sweetest name I know. Fills my every longing, keeps me singing as I go. I tell you, it's good to be able to sing. Have not been able to do that, and so praise the Lord. Glad that my voice has gotten better, and glad that you're here tonight. Let's go ahead and bow our heads in a word of prayer. Our Father, thank you that, Lord, we can assemble. I pray, Lord, that we would not take it for granted. But, Lord, may we make every time possible count. And just so, Lord, bless us tonight as we assemble. Lord, as we pray and as we look in your word, bless us, encourage us in our faith with thee. I ask in Jesus' name, amen. You may be seated. Welcome. It is good to have you. Just to point out, Sarah's dad is with us tonight, and he's here just visiting, I'm sure, Sarah. And Miguel, he's just there. So we're glad to have him here, and we hope and pray that just by way of prayer requests, and we have been, but obviously remember Sarah as she is dealing with her pregnancy, and it's a little touchy here and there, so far as we know, the baby's doing very well, so we thank the Lord for that. I think Sarah has an appointment, I don't know if it's next week, with the cardiologist, so pray for her concerning that, we pray that things will go well. But want to just remind you, this coming Sunday is our fifth Sunday, and as you know, we have dinner on the grounds, we have an early afternoon service, so be mindful of that. But we also have a guest with us this coming Sunday, and that is the Klein family. They are our missionaries to Ukraine. I've been looking forward to not only seeing them, but being able to talk with, the future of the ministry there and what's going to happen. So we get to hear it firsthand from the missionary. And so looking forward to spending time with that family. Looking forward, church, to be a blessing to that family. Amen. And so we want to sure to do that. But that is this coming Sunday. So be praying for the Klein family. That'll be our missionary tonight that we'll be praying for. So be mindful of that as well, okay? All right. One more hymn tonight, hymn number 391. I'd rather have Jesus. We'll sing the first and the last tonight. Sing it with me on the first. Here we go. I'd rather have Jesus than silver or gold. I'd rather be his than have riches untold. I'd rather have Jesus than houses or lands. I'd rather be led by His nail-pierced hand than to be the king of a vast domain, or be held in sin dread sway. I'd rather have Jesus than anything this world affords today. On the last now, join with us together. He's fairer than lilies of rarest bloom. He's sweeter than honey from out the comb. He's all that my hungering heart needs. I'd rather have Jesus and let Him lead than to be the king of a vast domain, or be held in sin's dread sway. I'd rather have Jesus than anything this world affords today. May we all have that conviction for sure. Brother Cross, if you'll come tonight, let's get ready. We're going to take an offering. On Wednesday night, we take an offering to help others, first of all in our church and then those outside of our church. If you give towards anything else, just make sure you designate it that it can get to where it needs to be, okay? All right, let's go ahead and bow our heads. Brother Cross, would you lead us? God bless you tonight as you give. Thank you, Bethany. It's good to have Bethany back. So we don't care about Bethany, but we like the piano. Amen. No, just kidding. Just kidding. Glad that she is doing better, and so she can play the piano. Tonight we are going to take some prayer requests, and so. As I said a little earlier, don't forget to be praying for our missionary tonight, the Klein family. And were we able to get that their picture? All right. I don't know if you recognize them, or you know, I don't know how, if you've seen them, and you know, I know we haven't seen them in a while, but this is the Klein family. They have six children, and so they are our missionaries to Ukraine, and so they'll be with us this coming Sunday. So now you know what they look like, and so obviously we want you to introduce yourself to them when you see them. But be praying for them tonight, okay, as we pray for our missionary. We also want to give you, I don't know if you want to call it an update. Many of you already may already know this, but Brother Duane passed away. I don't know anything as far as the funeral or anything like that yet. And so as we find out, we'll let the church know. Probably it'll be through our Facebook account. And so if you're not a part of that, because you cannot be a part of that unless you are invited to be a part of that. And so if you want to be a part of that, then I don't know who would that be? Would that be you, Marlia? Becky? Okay, Becky or Susan. So anyway, they can tell, because I know we have the church's one, and then we have the church's family one. So there are actually two of them there. But if you want to be a part of it and you're not, then see Becky or Susan, okay? Then also, be praying for the family, the Bruner family, and I've spoken to one of the sons. He let me know when it took place. They had decided as a family that they were going to take him off of the machine and see, you know, and just let it happen. Just whatever would have happened, if his lungs was strong enough, then he would survive and go from there. But if not, then they knew that heaven would be his home. So, and probably, I don't know, maybe about a day is how long that he lasted. And then early, I'm going to say either probably Tuesday, early Tuesday morning is when he passed. And so just pray for the family, okay? If you have a prayer request tonight, let's go ahead and start sharing them. Anyone? Barbara? Amen. Okay. All right. A lady by the name of Patty, we've known for a long time, but she had fallen in the apartment that she's in, and they determined it was because of a stroke. And so pray for Patty, and then also pray for Barbara's husband, Bud. He's with his knee. And he still has a nagging cough also, okay? All right, somebody else, you have a prayer request. Becky? Good. Amen. Somebody else, you have a prayer request? We ask once again that you pray for the Tagua family and with just the family as a whole. Just there's just a lot going on there, and pray, you know, the kids and all, pray for them all, that God's will be done, okay? So we requested prayer last week for that as well. And so, anybody else? Brother Mike? Brother Mike, pray for Mike Hopper and some tests coming up. Jackie Short's husband, Jim, he had a, they call it a heart surgery, and I don't know the details as far, I mean, I know what they did to some degree, but something about a place in his heart in that area that they had to feel, and so they went in up through the groin, and everything seemed to be successful. And they did that for future, so there wouldn't be any problems, you know, in the future. And so, but everything went well and accomplished. And he was, I believe, he's supposed to have already gone home now, based upon what I was told. So, but please continue to pray for him as he's home, recuperating from that particular surgery. Yes. All right, pray for Jim Summers. They've determined that he has nerve damage from the last surgery that he had on his back, and that's affecting his knee, but his knee was a problem anyway, and so they're going to schedule him for a knee replacement. And so just pray for Jim. I mean, seriously, it's pretty painful for Jim right now, and so this is. I mean, he doesn't complain at all. I mean, I would not have known it unless, you know, he had told me. But pray. Obviously, it must be serious enough, and so he's in a lot of pain. So. Pray for him that would subside. Pray for that the doctors will know what they need to do, and hopefully, and pray that it will work. I was told, you know, there's this 50-50 chance it may or may not. Well, I don't know about you, but we want it to be in the positive, right? And so pray that it will work and that everything will be okay. All right, somebody else, you have a prayer request. All right, church, let me remind you about our country, praying for our leadership, and praying for not only the leadership in a federal level, but also statewide here in the state of Indiana. And, you know, we've got our problems for sure. And so pray for our first responders and our police officers, and things like that, and that God's will be done there, and God would protect them as they do what they need to do. And we also want you to be praying for our missionaries, and specifically tonight, the Klein family. Let's lift them up tonight for wisdom, and obviously what God would have for them there in Ukraine. And then also pray for your church, and just pray for God's will to be done as well. And I tell you, if we don't have God's blessing, then then we don't have what we need, that's for sure. And so let's pray for God's blessing upon this place and his presence in our lives, okay? All right, so whether they're in your pew, at an altar someplace, we're going to spend some time in prayer, and then I'll close us in prayer. We'll get right into the Word of God, okay? Let's go to the Word in prayer. Lord, thank you tonight that we can once again assemble, and I pray tonight to look into your word that, Lord, it will speak to hearts, and Lord, help us to just learn and grow and be what you would have us to be, and so arrest our attention tonight, I ask in Jesus' name, amen. All right, eventually we will be in Philippians in chapter 3, so if you want to go ahead and turn there, that would be fine. I'm not going to get there right away, but while you're turning there, let me sort of introduce the subject matter. August 7th, 1954, the Vancouver Empire Games was hosted. And in that particular event, there was a particular race that probably was more anticipated than any other. It was between two individuals. And these were milers. In other words, they ran the mile. And both of these individuals that year had gone under the 4-minute mark. And now that may not mean anything to anyone, but for a runner, that's pretty good. And one of them was from England, Roger Bannister. And then the other one was from Australia, and his name was John Landy. Well, the final lap of this particular race, they both had won their heat, and they both made the finals. And so the race started, and Landy led all the way, or at least most of the way. That was his plan. His plan was to get out in the lead and hopefully run fast enough that Bannister did not have enough kick at the end, which he was famous for. And so Landy had led most of the way. And we find, though, according to the report, that Landy, just as he was nearing the finish line, looked to the left to see where Bannister was. But while he did that, Bannister passed him at the very last, and Bannister won the race by 0.8 of a second. And of course, you know, they both were celebrated, and both of them finished under 4 minutes, but it was Bannister that won. And one might say, well, the reason why he won was because Landy got distracted and was looking back when he should have been focused on the line and not worried about the other runner. You know, whenever we as Christians start looking around rather than focusing on our goal as a Christian, we are inevitably slowed down. Just like a car driver tends to steer in the direction he is looking, our lives tend to go towards whatever holds our focus. Tonight, we're going to be looking at the principle of concentration. The principle of concentration. And before we get to our passage, Proverbs chapter 4 and verse 25, Proverbs chapter 4 and verse 25 says this: "Let thine eyes look right on, and let thine eyelids look straight before thee. Ponder the path of thy feet, and let all thy ways be established. Turn not to the right hand, nor to the left. Remove thy foot from evil." Obviously, that passage is referring to focus, referring to concentrating. You know, it has within it the ideal of, have you ever heard what blinders? Especially on an animal, on a horse especially, a plow horse, blinders would put on horses, and the reason why, so they would not be distracted. Well, what do you mean? Well, obviously, a plow horse, you know, you needed to plow a straight line as best as possible. But it would be very difficult to do that if your horse kept going off because of being distracted one way or the other. So they would put blinders on the eyes so all they could see was straight ahead. Spiritually speaking, we need blinders so that we might be able to focus, if you please, on the goal at hand and not be so distracted. Let me read you this, Gospel of John in chapter 4. Gospel of John in chapter 4. Gospel of John in chapter 9, verse 4. Let me say it like that. Gospel of John in chapter 9 and verse 4. The Bible says this. Jesus is speaking, and he says this: "I must work the works of him that sent me while it is day. The night cometh when no man can work." Again, lending itself to that of being focused. apparently, you know, there was a certain time to work, and there was a work at hand. And Jesus says, I need to be focused on this because there's coming a time where I, you know, it will not be done. And so again, it emphasizes the ideal of, you know, not being distracted, but focused. One other scripture right quickly that just came to my mind. How many are familiar with a verse, for the love of money is the root of all evil, right? It's not that money is, but it's the love of money. In other words, and obviously what you and I ought to love more than anything else is Him. But if you and I are not careful, there's a lot of things that our hearts will desire, and you know what will happen? It will get us distracted and pulled away from what we are, really need to be doing. So you and I ought to be very careful. And so with that being said, Philippians chapter 3. Philippians chapter 3 tonight. The principle of concentration. I must keep my eyes fixed on the prize and not allow anything to distract me. Not allow anything to distract me. Philippians chapter 3, we find this truth being expressed by the Apostle Paul. Philippians, please. In chapter number 3. Let me start with verse number 4. The Bible says this, Though I might also have confidence in the flesh, if any other man thinketh that he hath whereof he might trust in the flesh, I more. It wasn't that Paul was bragging about himself, but he was making a point. He says, you know, if there's anyone that had the credentials, if there's anyone that had reason to boast in the flesh, he said, it was me. And he begins to lay it out. For the Bible says in verse 5, circumcised the eighth day of the stock of Israel, of the tribe of Benjamin, and Hebrew of the Hebrews, as touching the law, a Pharisee. In other words, he's listing all of his credentials concerning zeal, persecuting the church, touching the righteousness which is in the law, blameless. And so he says, if there's anyone that has reason to boast, if there's anyone that at least in the flesh has, you know, think of himself more highly than he ought to, he says, it's me. But look what it says in verse number 7. But what things were gained to me, those I counted loss for Christ. Now I want you to pay attention to what he's saying. Even though he had all these credentials, and I will say, you know, from the very outset, you know, okay, it's okay to have, you know, accolades. It's okay to be in certain positions and to study the law and to know the law. But anything, I don't care what it is, anything that hinders you from doing what God would have you to do, it will take you away from the things of God. And Paul here is expressing that, and this is the way he put it. He says, but what things were gained to me, those I counted loss for Christ. In other words, you know, the things that I were pursuing on my own and things that I wanted to do, and apparently he did them. He wanted all these things and he got them. But he says, all those things that you know, I got for myself, he says, those I counted lost for Christ. And he goes on and he says it like this, yea, doubtless, and I count all things but loss. I don't care what it is. I count all things but loss for the excellency of the knowledge of Christ Jesus my Lord, for whom I have suffered the loss of all things and do count them but dung, that I may win Christ, that I may gain Christ, that I may grow, he says, and be found in him, not having my own righteousness, which is of the law, but that which is through the faith of Christ, the righteousness which is of God by faith, that I may know him and the power of his resurrection and the fellowship of his suffering, being made conformable unto his death. So without a doubt, Paul says it is these things that are really more important. It is these things that I ought to keep my eye on. It is these things that are more important than all the accolades of this world and all the things that I could achieve. You know, what's more important is to do what God would have me to do, to know Him. And he lists those things. Listen to what the Bible says in verse number 10. That I may know him and the power of his resurrection and the fellowship of his suffering, being made conformable unto his death, if by any means I might attain unto the resurrection of the dead, not as though I had already obtained, either were already perfect. But I follow after, if that I may apprehend that for which also I am apprehended of Christ Jesus. Brethren, verse 13, I count not myself to have apprehended or arrived. But this one thing I do, forgetting those things which are behind and reaching forth unto those things which are before, I press toward the mark for the prize of the high calling of God in Christ Jesus. Without a doubt, Paul was quite, and here's the word that would fit this, he was quite focused. He was quite single-minded when it came to serving the Lord. And so tonight, we're looking at the principle of concentration, of not being distracted. Obviously, Hebrews chapter 12 expresses this same sentiment. Let me read that as well. Hebrews chapter 12. You all know it. We actually spent some time with it last time. But the Bible says in verse 1, wherefore seeing we also are compassed about with so great a cloud of witnesses, let us lay aside every weight and the sin which does so easily beset us, and let us run with patience the race that is set before us. Now we talked about the principle of weight and how to deal with that. But I want you to listen to verse 2. Looking unto Jesus, the author and finisher of our faith, who for the joy that was set before him endured the cross, despising the shame, and is set down at the right hand of the throne of God. Bible even says in verse 3, for consider him. In other words, again, the ideal is this. Think about Christ, looking unto Jesus. Focus on Christ as you run the race that God has for you. So, with that in mind, you know, things that would hinder that greater purpose, in other words, what God would have for us, those are the things you and I ought to be careful about, because we could easily be distracted when it comes to living for God. You know, it's one thing to say, hey, yes, I'm a Christian, but the question is, are you living the way God would have you to live? Are you doing what God would have you to do? Are you running the race that God would have you to run? And that is what's going to be more important when we stand before the Lord. And so as a child of God and as we focus on, you know, discipleship and being what God would have for us, for those that are serious about the Lord, I promise you, you know, the thing about it is when we stand before the Lord, we're going to be more concerned about, you know, did we do what he had wanted us to do? I tell you, it's not going to matter what, well, Lord, let me tell you what I did. It's not going to matter. Did you do what God wanted you to do while you were on this earth? God gave you the life that you have and all of that. What did you do with it? Did you do what he wanted you to do, or did you do what you wanted to do? And so that's the challenge. And so the principle as Christians, the principle is concentration, focused on the Lord, because that is what is important. I tell you, there are other passages that we could go to, but for the sake of time, let's go ahead and look at, that's the scripture that we looked at tonight. Letter A, where you are looking determines where you will be going. Where you are looking determines where you will be going. I don't know how many of you remember, as a young child, I say young child, I was a teenager, but I was still young enough that I could sit in my dad's lap and steer the car. Now, I couldn't touch the pedals, but I could do this. And so my dad every now and then would say, "Come here, son." And I was so excited he would let me steer. I thought I was actually driving the car. Not, I wasn't. All I was doing was just doing this. Of course, his hands were still on the steering wheel, but I didn't care. I loved it. But one day, and I've told you this story, I'm supposed to be driving the car and keeping it on the road, and they were telling the story in the back. So guess where my attention went? It went back there. Literally, my head also went back there. I'm listening to that, and guess where the car went? Well, it wasn't on the road. It was driving off the road. Of course, my dad was there, and he grabbed the wheel and jerked it back, and my dad said, "Oh, you're not supposed to do that. You can't listen to the story." "Well, why not, Dad? It's quite interesting. Your job is to do what? Focus on the road. You know, you cannot do that. And if you're going to learn to drive, you got to learn to focus on the road." And I tell you, in our spiritual life, we've got to learn to focus on Christ, because where we're looking determines where we're going. And aren't we supposed to be looking unto the Lord? That's you know, so vitally important. Our focus determines our direction. Our focus truly will determine our direction. You know, I've told you before in the analogy of a runner, especially in a 100-yard dash, but typically when they teach a runner to run, especially sprints, they tell you to pick a spot out in front, and you keep your eye out there in front so you run straight and you're not distracted from everything, but you focus on that. Because the truth of the matter is, if you're running and you're looking over there, you're eventually going to go that direction. And so the truth still applies. Letter A, where you are looking determines where you will be going. Letter B, don't focus on the other runners in the race. Don't focus on the other runners in the race. Gospel of John in chapter 21 illustrates this. The Gospel of John in chapter 21. You know, there are some people that notice others more than they actually notice themselves. They're more concerned about what everyone else is doing rather than what they're doing. Gospel of John in chapter 21, the Bible says this in verse 21. I'm just going to start with verse number, Jesus is speaking here, and he says to Peter, and we all know this, verse 16 and verse 17, and over again, Jesus says to Peter, "Feed my sheep, feed my lambs." And in verse 18, Jesus says this, "Verily, verily, I say unto thee, when thou wast young, thou girdest thyself and walkest whither thou wouldest. But when thou shalt be old, thou shalt stretch forth thine hands, and another shall gird thee and carry thee whither thou wouldest not." This, verse 19, "This spake he, signifying by what death he should glorify God. And when he had spoken this, he said unto him, Follow me. Then Peter, turning about, seeing the disciple whom Jesus loved following," which, by the way, was John, "which also leaned on his breast at supper, and said, Lord, which is he that betrayeth thee? Peter, seeing him, saith to Jesus, Lord, what shall this man do?" Referring to John. "Jesus saith unto him, If I will that he tarry till I come, what is that to thee? Follow thou me." You know, so often that's our response. "Lord, but what about this guy?" Peter was more concerned about John and what his future was. And after Jesus had told Peter about his future, and so Peter says, "Yeah, but what about him?" And Jesus basically says, "What is that to you, Peter?" And so often, if you're not careful, we'll be more concerned about what the other runner is doing. And we'll get so distracted from what we're supposed to do. You see, so often we forget, we ought to stay in our own lane and run our own race the way God would have us to run it and focus on the finish line. And so often, many Christians get tripped up and many Christians get so out of focus and they never actually accomplish what God would have them accomplish because they're so focused on the other runner. And boy, I tell you, I could spend a lot more time on this. I don't know about you, but I have enough in my own life to keep myself doing what God would have me to do. So often remember the analogy of the camel going through an eye of a needle, and yet we're so concerned about what somebody else is doing, but what about them? How about worrying about just what you need to worry about? And let's deal with the mote that's in your own eye. Let's deal with the troubles in your own life. And let's just focus on doing what God would have. I think our churches would be so much better if we would do that. Instead of looking around and saying, well, nobody else is doing it, I don't think I will. Wouldn't it be better if we would just say, Lord, is that what you want me to do? Okay, I'll do that. And not focus on what people are doing or what people are not doing. And so, this is an excellent point, and that is, don't focus on other runners in the race because it will truly distract you from listening to what God would have you to do. Letter C. When we stop looking at Jesus, we are headed for trouble. That's just a blanket statement, but boy, it is so true. When we stop looking at Jesus, in other words, considering him, looking for him for direction, then we're, I don't care how you look at it. Truth of the matter is, anytime we stop taking advice from the Lord, when we stop obeying him, you're going to head into trouble. You really are. Peter on the water. Remember that scenario? Take your Bible and turn to Matthew chapter 14. Matthew chapter 14. I love this account in many ways, but I want you to notice something here. Matthew chapter 14, and obviously there's a storm The people in the ship, the disciples in the ship, they really were frightened, and they really actually thought that Jesus was a ghost and all of that. He says, "Be of good cheer; it is I. Be not afraid." But I want you to notice in verse number 30. Of course, if you remember what Peter says, "Lord, if that is you, bid me come to you," right? And so what did Jesus do? Come on. And so Peter does. And for that brief moment, Peter walked on water. How many of you could say that? Yeah. But look, if you would, in verse 30, though. "But when he saw the wind boisterous, he was" what? He was afraid. "And beginning to sink, he cried, saying, Lord, save me." So I will say to you, and you at least have to acknowledge the fact that when he took his eyes off of the Lord, when he lost focus, and what was he more focused on? What was he more looking at? He was looking at his surroundings. He probably was hearing the wind and the waves. He probably saw how big the waves were, and something entered his heart that maybe was not there before, and that was fear. And it began to dominate his life and at that particular moment. And as you know, he began to sink. And thankfully, he cried out to the Lord. And what did the Lord do? Sorry, buddy, you're gone. No, he didn't do that. He obviously delivered and he saved him. Aren't you thankful for the grace of God? Even though you make a mistake, God still can lift you up and put you on the right track. Thank God for that. Even when we lose focus, you know, God's not going to, can I tell you, it's always better to keep your eyes on the Lord. Always better. For anyone to stand up and say, no, I didn't and I'm okay, he's selling something. It's not true. It's not true. But aren't you thankful, though, that when we do get our eyes off the Lord, there's a way back. God can deliver us and put us back on the path that we ought to be going, which we should have been going in the first place. But we can so easily be distracted and go our own little way and think we're doing well. And I tell you, but we always get in trouble. Peter obviously is a good example of that here in this particular account. When we stop looking at Jesus, when we stop focusing on Christ, we are headed for trouble. And that is so true. Letter D. Last one. If you don't lose focus, this is another statement. It's almost like we want to say, I know that. But if you don't lose focus, you won't make changes that take you away from the truth. I tell you, this is so vitally important. I have met people and what I knew them before, and then you meet them later, and they have all kinds of changes in their life, things that they do now that they didn't believe before. And I would have to say that the changes in their life now is not according to the Word of God. But I tell you, a lot of times people justify the changes in their life because they don't want to admit, hey, I got away from God. And so wherever they're at, they justify it by you know, making up some kind of lie because that's what they have to do. You know, as a disciple of the Lord Jesus Christ, I promise, you know, without a doubt how important it is, you know, don't lose focus on the Lord. In other words, that's how come it is so vitally important to keep your eyes on Him, to always be concerned about what God thinks. You know when the Bible says Proverbs. No, I think it's in Psalms. Guard your heart, for out of it are the issues of life. The ideal is there, you know, the heart has a tendency and it can go after anything, right? And so you are to guard it. What for? Well, the ideal is this, guard it so that bad things will not take your heart away, but guard it so that it'll desire the things of God. That it'll desire Christ, and so we are to guard it, we are to protect it, we are to watch over it, make sure, no. So everything that passes by and everything that you know, we are to make sure, no, is that of God? Well, if it's not of God, sorry, I don't want it. Don't want to be a part of that. Because our hearts can easily go after things. The point here is, if you don't lose focus, you won't make changes that take you away from the truth. And that is so true. You know, one might ask the question, why do you believe what you say you believe? Because there was a time that you did not believe that. So what happened? Hello? Hey, you used to believe in the virgin birth. You used to believe in prayer. You used to believe that this is the Word of God. You used to believe that. What happened? Can I tell you, it didn't happen overnight. But little by little, we begin to change. How many are familiar with the University of Harvard? Everybody probably knows about Harvard. Did you know, though, that in its founding, it was a training ground for pastors for the ministry? The University of Harvard. For the colonies at that time. Well, the motto of the college, the short version was Veritas, meaning truth. Well, the original motto was this: truth for Christ and His church. That was the original motto of the University of Harvard. If I'm not mistaken, based upon the information that I got, the chaplain for the University of Harvard today is an atheist. Kind of doesn't make sense, does it? Well, how in the world did they get to there? Well, it was little by little. And, of course, today, Harvard is a very liberal school. A very liberal school. And, just like that, any Christian can get away from God's will for their life. Any Christian can deviate from the plan of God. And a lot of times it's little by little, making little decisions here and there that are not pleasing to the Lord. And what you'll finally wind up, looking at, when you look back, you'll see, wow, look how far off I've gotten away from what Christ would want me to do. How important this principle of concentration. Folks, it's not going to happen automatically. As a child of God, you and I ought to, with much effort and desire by the grace of God, focus on Christ. And folks, like I said, there are times you're going to have to make yourself focus on Christ. Your flesh is not going to desire it all the time. I'll give you an example. Attending the house of God, worshiping Him. By the way, that's a biblical truth. But we as humans can actually say, it's not that important. Well, that's just one decision that will slowly, little by little, downplay the truth of God. Oh, I don't have to read my Bible. I get enough of that at church. Well, there's another truth that you've belittled. And little by little, especially when we take our focus off of Him and our focus is on something else, and that focus on something else dominates our time and dominates our energy and dominates our money, eventually, that's what's going to point our direction. I don't care what you do. I don't care where you go. Focus. Christ should always be our main focus. Christ should always be every decision we make, everything that we do. We ought to consider Christ. Hebrews chapter 2, and I'm almost done, so Bear with me. Hebrews chapter 2. Listen to this, please. Hebrews chapter 2, notice if you would, in verse 1, the Bible says it like this: therefore, we ought to give the more earnest heed to the things which we have heard, lest at any time we should let them slip. And if you and I are not careful, we can easily let the things of God slip. We can easily lose sight of what God has said. There's a parable called that of the sower, referring to the Word of God. And one of the analogies that is given is about the devil coming and doing what with the Word of God? You know, quickly removing it. And so how important it is that you and I focus on what the Lord says. What I mean by focus, I'm talking about retaining it. I'm talking about, you know, applying it. I'm talking about learning it. And we ought to do it. We ought to do it quickly. Because apparently the devil thinks God and His will is so important that he'll do everything he can to keep you away from it. So may we concentrate on the things of the Lord. Right quickly, consider some of these questions. Just for your own application. Keep your focus on Christ and you will keep moving forward for Him. Amen. That is true. Number two, is pleasing and obeying the Lord my central focus in life? Is it? It ought to be. I'm just encouraging you and challenging you. Number three, does the way I spend my time, my talent, and money reflect a focus on God or on something else? Think about it. Just think about it. Because normally what has your time, your talent, and your money normally is what's pretty important to you. Just telling you. Number four, have I fallen into the habit of evaluating and critiquing others rather than myself? You know, it's so much easier to pick apart somebody else rather than look at your own life. Yeah. By the way, if we look at someone else's, we don't have to look at our own life. So, number five, am I committed to serving God no matter what comes? Hope so. Number six, have I allowed changes to what I believe and do because of the loss of focus? In other words, have we changed what we believe because we've lost our focus? Hey, you used to believe that. Why don't you now? Number seven, am I looking to God as my ultimate source of supply and approval? Because that's what ought to matter most of all. I don't care what the majority thinks. I don't care what everyone else thinks. What should be important to you and I, well, what does God think? That's what matters most of all. And I tell you, if that's what matters most of all, I promise you, that'll keep you on track. It'll keep you focused. It'll keep you doing what God would have you to do when you value what God thinks over what anyone else says. By the way, remember Potiphar? Potiphar's wife and Joseph, right? And you know what she did, correct? She confronted him and said, I want you, and she threw herself on him, and he did not want to have anything to do with her. And he told her, he says, how can I do this great wickedness and sin against God? And I will tell you, where in the world did he get that? Well, obviously he was taught it, but he valued what God thought more than what she had. Think about it. In other words, to Joseph, what was more important is what God thought. That's why he responded and says, woman, how can I do this and sin against God? By the way, just because two people agree doesn't take away the sin. It's still wrong. But boy, when we focus on Christ and then it helps us in our decisions. It helps us in keeping where we ought to keep. So, amen. Praise the Lord. The principle of concentration. May you and I always focus on Christ. That's more important than anything else. Let's pray. Father, I pray your blessing upon tonight. And Lord, I pray that you would help us in our daily living. And Lord, may we exercise that, you know what you're talking about, and that you and what you say are more important. Help us to evaluate our lives in light of you and what you say. And Lord, help us by your grace and strength align our lives up with what you say. Lord, help us to keep our eyes on the Lord. In Jesus' name, amen. God bless you. You're dismissed.